Meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, Neues entsteht in vielen, wenn nicht in den meisten Fällen so, dass Dinge, Ideen, Institutionen nicht ex nihilo, voraussetzungslos ganz neu gemacht werden, sondern dass bereits Vorhandenes neu gesehen, neu durchdacht, neu strukturiert wird. So verhält es sich auch bei dem neuen Forschungs- und Bibliotheksverbund MAIA, den wir heute Abend vorstellen. Und ich betone wir, denn es handelt sich um ein Münchner Gemeinschaftsprojekt des Bayerischen Nationalmuseums, des Instituts für Ägyptologie und Koptologie der LMU, des Instituts für klassische Archäologie der LMU, des Museums Fünf Kontinente und des Zentralinstituts für Kunstgeschichte. Worum geht es bei MAIA? Die Antwort umfasst zwei Aspekte. Einer betrifft die Forschung, der andere die Wissenschaftsinfrastruktur. Und es ist eigentlich egal, mit welchem ich anfange, denn beide sind unauflösbar miteinander verbunden, scheint mir. Für die Forschung in allen genannten Bereichen ist in den letzten Jahren zunehmend deutlich geworden oder noch deutlicher geworden, dass alte Fachgrenzen, Beschränkungen hinsichtlich der behandelten Objekte und Geografien, aber auch Fragen und Methoden angesichts neuer Herausforderungen und eines immer globaleren Blicks in vieler Hinsicht verändert, erweitert, neu konzipiert werden müssen. Dabei teilen eigentlich klassische Archäologie, Ägyptologie, Kunstgeschichte und eine Erforschung von Kunst und Ästhetik in allen Kontinenten, die lange Zeit als ethnologisch bezeichnet wurde, alle diese Forschungsrichtungen teilen eigentlich eine gemeinsame Vorgeschichte, bevor sie sich als wissenschaftliche Disziplinen im Laufe des späten 19. und dann 20. Jahrhunderts auseinanderentwickelt und spezialisiert haben. So wichtig diese disziplinären Prozesse waren, deutlich wird, dass wir heute nicht mehr nur an der Spezialisierung, sondern genauso wieder an den gemeinsamen Herausforderungen und an den Schnittstellen arbeiten müssen. Das betrifft unmittelbar alle hier vertretenen Disziplinen und Institutionen mit der Diskussion, wie mit Kunstwerken in westlichen Sammlungen und Ausstellungskontexten umzugehen ist, also von Nofretete über Parthenonfries und Benin-Bronzen bis hin zu umstrittenen Denkmälern und Aktgemälden. Es beschränkt sich aber keineswegs auf solche Fragen von Provenienz, Museologie und öffentlicher Präsentation. Tatsächlich geht es darum, wie die ästhetische Produktion der Menschen insgesamt konzeptualisiert wird, wie eine angemessen komplexe Untersuchung, wie eine Geschichte der Architektur, Malerei, Skulptur und so weiter heute aussehen muss und wie sie überhaupt möglich ist. Für unsere vernetzte globale Gegenwart dürfte das unmittelbar einleuchten. Für die Archäologien war der Mittelmeerraum wahrscheinlich immer schon die wichtigere Größe als Europa. Und Projekte wie etwa die Felsbildnachzeichnungen durch Leo Frobenius Anfang des 20. Jahrhunderts zeigen, wie die damalige Ethnologie eine weltumspannende Perspektive verfolgte. Die Kunstgeschichte in Deutschland ist wahrscheinlich als letzte Disziplin in den vergangenen 2-3 Jahrzehnten klar geworden, dass die künstliche Grenzziehung auf westliche Kunst wenig Sinn macht. Klar ist aber auch, dass allein schon die Verwendung des Begriffs Kunst, ein Begriff und Konzept des europäischen 18. Jahrhunderts, dass also allein schon Kunst den Vorwurf provozieren kann, dass hier bei allem Bemühen letztlich doch wieder westliche Denkweisen auf die anderen übertragen werden. Es ist diese herausfordernde Situation, auf die wir mit MAIA reagieren wollen. Das Akronym MAIA steht für Munich Artifacts Images Architecture. Also Sie sehen, dass wir Kunst vermeiden. Gemeint sind damit 5 Forschungsinstitute und Bibliotheken in München, die zusammen weitgehend das historische und geografische Spektrum zur Produktion von Bildern, Objekten und Architekturen der Welt von Ägypten bis heute umfassen. Und was ich vielleicht auch dazu sagen kann, ist, dass natürlich das Ganze jetzt ein Aufschlag ist und es nichts dagegen spricht, auch noch eine 6., 7. und 8. Bibliothek und Institution aufzunehmen. MAIA schließt diese Institutionen zu einem Netzwerk zusammen. Deshalb haben wir die Sterngruppe der Plejaden als Sinnbild gewählt, unter denen ein Stern eben MAIA ist. Maya, also als Bestandteil der Sternengruppe der Plejaden, die zum Sternbild Stier gehören. Und wir hoffen natürlich, dass der Umstand, dass wir heute am 21. April das Projekt vorstellen, also dem ersten Tag des Sternzeichens Stier, dass das ein günstiges Vorzeichen ist. Der neue Zusammenschluss der fünf Institutionen soll noch deutlicher vor Augen führen, dass München ein hervorragender Standort genau für diese Art der Forschung ist, mit einem Angebot an Forschungsinfrastrukturen, Bibliotheken, die so wahrscheinlich nicht mehr oft zu finden sein dürfte. MAIA ist zunächst einmal ein gemeinsamer Verbundkatalog der beteiligten fünf Institutionen, der über 1 Million Bücher erschließt. Aber es geht nicht nur um einen virtuellen Katalog. Ab Mai erproben wir ein gemeinsames Leih- und Liefersystem zwischen den Bibliotheken, sodass die Leserinnen und Leser in jeder der fünf Bibliotheken wirklich Zugriff auf das gesamte Angebot haben, nicht nur auf die immer noch sehr begrenzte digitalisierte Literatur. Spätestens hier wird deutlich, wie Forschung und Infrastruktur eben untrennbar ineinandergreifen. Die Grenzen von Zeiten, Orten und Fächern sind bislang eben auch Grenzen der Verfügbarkeit von Literatur in einer Bibliothek an einem Ort. Dagegen wollen wir eine innovative Forschungsumgebung jenseits alter Grenzen schaffen. Schließlich richten wir ein Fellowship ein, das wir gemeinsam besetzen, das Personen, die an solchen disziplinübergreifenden Fragestellungen im Sinne von MAIA arbeiten, dieses Fellowship soll denen ermöglichen, zwischen 2 und 4 Wochen in München in den MAIA-Bibliotheken zu arbeiten. Dass die fünf Institutionen von MAIA diesen neuen Forschungsverbund begründen, hat aber nicht nur mit neuen Forschungsfragen zu tun und nicht nur mit dem Bemühen, dass Universität, außeruniversitäre Forschungseinrichtungen und Museen zukünftig noch enger zusammenarbeiten. Es ist auch ein wichtiges Signal für die kollegial-freundschaftliche, produktive Zusammenarbeit der beteiligten Institutionen und Personen, die überhaupt erst Funken aus dieser Münchner Forschungsinfrastruktur schlagen. Ich danke allen Beteiligten ganz herzlich, dass wir das MAIA-Projekt nun zusammen realisieren. Die Kolleginnen und Kollegen Ruth Bielfeld, Friedhelm Hoffmann, ich weiß nicht, ob Frank Matthias Kammel in der ersten Reihe schon da ist, aber er ist da, und Uta Wehrlich, werden gleich noch die anderen Institutionen vorstellen. Ich danke hier aber auch sehr den Bibliothekarinnen und Bibliothekaren am Bayerischen Nationalmuseum, Aurika Schön und Elisabeth Moselage. Ich danke Gertraud Remmers und Martin Gross am Museum 5 Kontinente, Barbara Birk und Andreas Mittermeier von der Archäologie und Ägyptologie der LMU, Viktoria Reuchle, die die wissenschaftliche Betreuung der Bibliothek der Archäologen, und Alexander Schütze, der die wissenschaftliche Betreuung für die Ägyptologen innehat. Am ZI schließlich besonders Rüdiger Heuer, Annette Köppe, Christiane Lohse und Martin Stahl. Dass wir den MAIA-OPAC realisieren konnten, wäre ohne die große Hilfe durch die Bayerische Staatsbibliothek nicht möglich gewesen. Herr Stefanos Nikudis hier, ich glaube, Sie sind hier. Grüß Sie. Der heute hier ist, ganz herzlichen Dank an Sie und an Ihr Team für die großartige Unterstützung und Betreuung dieser Benutzeroberfläche. Und am ZI schließlich hat Sonja Nagakawa das Projekt und die Anfertigung der Website hervorragend betreut. Und Sie sehen hier einen Screenshot. Auf der Seite werden verschiedene Fotos durchlaufen, die das Spektrum sozusagen der Objekte deutlich machen. Und ich kann Sie nur einladen, alle MAIA Research.org dann zu benutzen. Also Sie sehen, wir versuchen das so schlicht wie möglich zu halten. Das erste ist mal einfach ein Suchschlitz, wo Sie auf diese 1 Million Bücher zugreifen können. Es gibt dann natürlich eine zweite Ebene, wo auch komplexere Abfragen oder spezifischere Eingrenzungen möglich sind. Vor dem Vortrag übergebe ich jetzt an die Kolleginnen und Kollegen, die ihre jeweiligen Institute kurz vorstellen. Vielen Dank, dass Sie alle hier sind.
Es ist mir eine große Freude, im Namen des Instituts für klassische Archäologie, namentlich meinem Kollegen Professor Stefan Ritter, aber auch Frau Dr. Reuchle, Herr Dr. Henke sind hier, und all den anderen Kolleginnen und Kollegen am Institut für klassische Archäologie, hier kurz nicht so sehr unser Institut vorzustellen, sondern letztlich auch, was es bedeutet, dass wir in diesem Forschungs- und Bibliotheksverbund mitwirken dürfen. Und das ist uns wirklich eine große Herzensangelegenheit. Maya, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, Munich Artifacts, Images, Architectures klingt für die klassische Archäologie der LMU sehr verheißungsvoll. Maya, das ist diese Nymphe, eine arkadische Nymphe, Geliebte des Zeus, Mutter des Hermes, dieses Gottes, der schon als Baby alles bereits in die Wiege gelegt zu haben schien. Klugheit, Schnelligkeit, Redegewandtheit, Witz, Musik, sozialer und ökonomischer Erfolg. Wenn also Hermes für dieses Projekt steht, besser kann es uns eigentlich gar nicht gehen. Kaum geboren erfand er die Leier, bestahl seinen Bruder Apoll um eine ganze Rinder- oder wie wir heute denken wollen, Stierherde, log aus seiner Wiege heraus so charmant, dass sich die Balken bogen. Apoll konnte sich diesem Charme nicht entziehen und wurde Hermes bester Freund und Lieblingsbruder. Ich konnte mich nicht enthalten, Ihnen hier zwei Stücke zu zeigen, zwei Gefäße des späten 6. Jahrhunderts, die die Spannweite unserer Forschungen zeigen, ein attisches Gefäß und ein etruskisches Gefäß. Also wir bewegen uns eben im Mittelmeerraum. Und jeweils sehen wir hier Hermes mit einer Frau, die wir gerne als Maya benennen würden. Sie tritt zwar anonym auf, Sie sehen ihn hier erwachsen und hier ganz recht im Kreis auf seiner Wiege als Kleinkind eingewickelt, aber nur ein scheinbares Baby, der es faustdick hinter den Ohren hat. Maya, also diese Mutter dieses Kindes, später unter die Sterne versetzt, ist in jeder Hinsicht ein gutes Omen. Denn diese gemeinsame Forschungs-, wie ich sie gerne sehen will, und Bibliotheksinitiative vereint genau dieses smart, schnell, grenzenüberwindend, geistiges, musisches und emotionales Kapital schaffend. Herr Pfisterer hat schon auf diesen Funken, der zwischen uns Forscherinnen und Forschern entsteht, verwiesen. Von jedem der beteiligten Institutionen wird jetzt jeder Forscherin, jedem Forscher die Bücher Hermes gleich gewissermaßen auf den Schreibtisch fliegen. Die klassische Archäologie als eine der besten Institutsbibliotheken für klassische Archäologie weltweit beteiligt sich mit sage und schreibe 45.000 Bänden. Und mit diesen Büchern wächst noch einmal mehr zusammen, was längst zusammengewachsen ist, die archäologisch, kunsthistorisch und anthropologisch arbeitenden Forschungs- und Museumseinrichtungen Münchens. Und das Münchner Modell kann nun in die Welt ausstrahlen. Historische Forschung an Bildern, Artefakten und Architekturen kennt keine Fachgrenzen mehr, das hat Herr Pfisterer gesagt. Radikal haben sich unsere Fragestellungen verändert. Nehmen wir das Pariser Gefäß hier. Vor 30 Jahren hätte man noch Fragen zur Gefäßtypologie, zur Zeitstellung und zum etruskischen Vasenmaler aus der Connoisseurship heraus gefragt. Heute bietet so ein Gefäß einen Kosmos neuer anthropologisch motivierter Fragen, die zum Kulturvergleich einladen und die uns immer wieder zurückbinden an unsere heutigen Erfahrungen. Das sind die Fragen nach dem Verhältnis von Kindheit und Familie, von Mythos und Alltag. Ist das Hermes oder nicht doch irgendein Baby im Etrurien des 6. Jahrhunderts? Welches Bild von Kindheit wird hier überhaupt entwickelt? Denn das, was Sie hier sehen, ist kein bloßer Eimer, es ist eine ins Ding gepackte Lebensgeschichte. Da ist die große Frage nach dem Schein und dem Sein der Bilder. Kann ein Bild lügen wie ein Gott? Kann es kamuflieren? Camouflage ist das große Forschungsthema unseres heutigen Gastes, Caroline van Eck. Oder müssen Bilder immer die Wahrheit sagen? Da sind die Fragen nach der Materialität von Technik, Herstellung, Handling. Hatte der etruskische Meister sich die schwarzfigurige Technik experimentell erarbeitet? Und was bedeutet es eigentlich, wenn wir heute sagen, das ist gut gemacht oder weniger gut? Da sind Fragen nach Ökonomie, Handel und Vernetzung. Was war der Eimer wert? Hat er je Wasser enthalten? Wer stellte ihn sich ins Grab? Ist Hermes etwa ein Stand-in für ein Kind, das sich totstellt? Und da ist die große Frage nach diesen Gefäßen als Kulturerbe, das wir erhalten, beforschen, interpretieren und neu präsentieren müssen und wollen. Nicht zuletzt im Hinblick auf ihre Provenienz. Herr Pfisterer hat das angesprochen. Warum sind diese Gefäße überhaupt in unseren Museen? Was ist die Langzeitwirkung der gewaltsamen napoleonischen Kulturpolitik, der sich beide Gefäße verdanken? Zu solchen Fragestellungen gab es einen sehr gewinnbringenden Schwerpunkt des Center for Advanced Study der LMU, Materiality Museology Knowledge, an dem die Archäologien der LMU, die Kunstgeschichte und die Münchner Museen, allen voran das Museum Fünf Kontinente, beteiligt waren. Universitäten und Museen sind Forschungsinstitutionen, die hier in München am Beginn neuer, spannender Kooperationen stehen, weil sie gemeinsam einen gesellschaftlichen Auftrag haben, nämlich die vormodernen und die außereuropäischen Kulturen mit unserem Heute in Dialog zu bringen. Maja, mir gefällt dieses Logo der Plejaden, dieser Sternenhaufen, der für die funkelnden Chancen der Zusammenarbeit steht, die der neue Verbund uns allen bieten wird. Lieber Ulrich Pfisterer, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen von Museen und der LMU, liebe Kolleginnen der Staatsbibliothek, herzlichen Dank für diese Initiative.
Ja, grüß Gott, meine Damen und Herren. Ich spreche für das Institut für Ägyptologie und Koptologie, möchte es ganz kurz halten und auch einfach. Die Ägyptologie behandelt alles, was mit dem alten Ägypten zu tun hat. So könnte man es ganz platt sagen. Von der Archäologie über die Architektur, die Kunst hin zu Texten und Sprache, von der Steinzeit und Vorgeschichte bis zur arabischen Zeit. Man hat schon treffend von der innerfachlichen Universalität der Ägyptologie gesprochen, mit Verbindungen zu einer Vielzahl von Fächern, auch zu den Naturwissenschaften hin. Dazu kommt die Koptologie, die sich mit dem spätantiken christlichen Ägypten beschäftigt und mit der Theologie eng verbunden ist. Theologie fehlt uns eigentlich noch in unserem Maya-Verbund, ne? 1923, also vor exakt 100 Jahren, wurde in München das Institut für Ägyptologie gegründet. Damit gehört das Institut in München zu den älteren ägyptologischen Instituten in Deutschland. Und dank der Förderung durch unser Collegium Ägyptium können wir tatsächlich praktisch jedes Buch aus unserem Fach kaufen. Wir haben daher eine der weltweit größten ägyptologischen Bibliotheken. Im Geiste von Maya sind, denke ich, auch einige Kooperationen erwähnenswert. Da ist zunächst zu nennen die Online Egyptological Bibliography, die in Oxford und München gemacht wird. Es ist die umfassendste ägyptologische Bibliografie überhaupt, die inzwischen schon seit vielen Jahren natürlich online zur Verfügung steht. Und dann die Munich Digital Research Archives mit dem Akronym MUDIRA. Das ist eine mit Metadaten angereicherte Online-Bilddatenbank, die in Kooperation mit dem Ägyptischen Museum in München entsteht. Aktuell sind über 50.000 Bilder bereits online gestellt. Und egal, ob Sie in der OEB, der Online Egyptological Bibliography, oder in MUDIRA mal hineinschauen und Maya als Suchbegriff eingeben, dann werden Sie fündig werden. Es ist in Ägypten nämlich ein Männername. Und von einem berühmten Herrn Maya gibt es auch entsprechende Denkmäler. Vielen Dank.
Meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren, verehrte Kolleginnen und Kollegen, muss man das Bayerische Nationalmuseum in München eigentlich noch vorstellen? Nein. Andererseits mache ich immer wieder die Erfahrung, dass mich Menschen ansprechen, wo liegt das eigentlich? Und da müsste ich auch mal hingehen. Also insofern vielleicht doch. Einfach nur ein paar Facts zu diesem Haus, das 1855 auf Initiative von König Maximilian II. Gegründet worden ist, also 168 Jahre alt, an seinem dritten Standort sitzt in der Prinzregentenstraße. und gegründet wurde als ein bayerisches Geschichtsmuseum eigentlich, zumindest Kulturgeschichtsmuseum, relativ schnell sich dann zu einem eher Kunstgewerbemuseum entwickelt hat und heute ein kunst- und kulturgeschichtliches Museum ist, das die Sparten Kunstgeschichte von der Ausbildung her, Volkskunde und auch Landesgeschichte umfasst. Das Haus hatte ursprünglich den Auftrag, von den Anfängen bis zur damaligen Gegenwart zu sammeln. Inzwischen ist aus diesem Haus heraus eine Reihe von Töchtern entstanden, sodass wir nicht mehr die Römer und nicht mehr die Merowinger und auch nicht mehr vor- und frühgeschichtliche Artefakte zeigen. Die sind inzwischen alle in der Archäologischen Staatssammlung gelandet. Und dass wir auch nicht mehr den Teil haben, der heute als neue Sammlung firmiert. Das war eigentlich die Abteilung der modernen Kunst, des modernen Kunstgewerbes des Bayerischen Nationalmuseums, das 1946/47 einen eigenen Status bekommen hat und wie Sie heute wissen, nicht mehr in unserem Gebäude an der Prinzregentenstraße sitzt, sondern Teil der Pinakothek der Moderne ist, sodass unser eigentlicher Sammlungsauftrag mit dem Jugendstil endet, aber in vielen Bereichen auch darüber hinausgeht. Warum erzähle ich das? Neben dem Haus gibt es auch momentan noch 8 Zweigmuseen von Kronach bis nach Ichenhausen und von Obernzell bis nach Schleißheim, die einzelne Sammlungsspektren auch darstellen. Warum erzähle ich das? Weil sich eigentlich darin der Bestand unserer Bibliothek widerspiegelt. 13.000 Quadratmeter Ausstellungsfläche für Kunst und Kultur und gut 100.000 Medien, sagen wir heute, in unserer Bibliothek. Jährlich um 1.500 bis 2.000 Medien erweitert. Medien deswegen, weil es inzwischen nicht nur mehr Bücher sind oder nicht nur die 30 laufenden Zeitschriften, die wir etwa abonniert haben, sondern weil natürlich auch digitale Medien inzwischen dazukommen, sicher wie auch in den Häusern, die eben schon angesprochen worden sind. Ich danke in dieser Hinsicht meinen beiden Mitarbeiterinnen, die auch hier sind, Arika Schön und vor allen Dingen Frau Moselage und auch Frau Rieger, die inzwischen ausgeschieden ist, die als Herr Professor Pfister auf uns zukam und ich diese Idee sehr gut fand, sich zu vernetzen, weil ich Ideen der Vernetzung immer sehr gut finde, weil es eigentlich nur zu Bereicherung und zu wissenschaftlichem Mehrwert führen kann, sich in dieser Sache sehr engagiert haben. Also in dieser Hinsicht meinen herzlichen Dank. Und ich denke, diese Bibliothek, die wir haben, hat zumindest ein Alleinstellungsmerkmal. Wir sind natürlich mit gut 100.000 Medien eher der kleinere Player in dem großen Verbund. Aber vielleicht irre ich mich, aber ich hoffe nicht. Wir sind das einzige Haus, das einen Bibliotheksturm hat, einen wirklichen Turm. Also Sie können wie bei Umberto Eco im Namen der Rose, wenn Sie in unsere Bibliothek kommen, in einen Turm gehen. Also der Turm, den Sie wirklich sehen an der Prinzregentenstraße, dort sitzt unsere Bibliothek. Und ich sage eigentlich immer, welches Museum hat schon 30 Goldfische im Garten, eine Uhr, die wirklich geht genau, und einen Turm, in dem eine Bibliothek sitzt, das ist nur das Bayerische Nationalmuseum. Insofern sind wir froh, in diesem Verbund zu sein. Und der Verbund kann sich freuen, dass wir einen Turm mit an der Sache haben. Und weil jetzt so viel schon gesagt worden ist über Maya, ich gehe da eher lautmalerisch davon aus und denke immer als Kind, vor allem der 70er Jahre, an die Biene Maya. Bienenfleiß ist auch etwas ganz Wichtiges für die Forschung und für die Bibliothek. Und ich denke auch, selbst wenn man neben der hohen ägyptologischen und hohen antiken Kunst auch an die Biene Maya denkt, dann ist das für die Forschung vielleicht auch kein schlechtes Bild. Herzlichen Dank, dass wir dabei sein dürfen. Wir bemühen uns herzlich und hoffen, dass wir diesen Mehrwert, der prognostiziert worden ist, dann auch erfüllen können. Vielen Dank.
Ja, auch von meiner Seite einen schönen guten Abend. Ich darf heute hier sprechen als Direktorin des Museums 5 Kontinente, das Sie sicherlich alle schon einmal besucht haben. Deshalb nur ganz kurz, thematisch widmen wir uns den Kulturen und Künsten der Welt und entsprechend sind unsere Sammlungen aufgebaut. 160.000 Objekte verwahren wir aus Asien, aus Afrika, den Amerikas, aus Europa, Australien und Ozeanien und versuchen mit diesen vor allem historisch zusammengestellten Sammlungen Brücken von der Vergangenheit in die Gegenwart zu schlagen und für vermeintlich fremde Sichtweisen und Lebensentwürfe Türen zu öffnen. Über das Museum selbst möchte ich gar nicht so viel erzählen, sondern über unsere Bibliothek. Die ist sehr schön und umfasst inzwischen rund 100.000 Bände, davon ca. 120 Zeitschriften, die derzeit betreut werden von Martin Groß und Gertraud Remmers, die heute Abend auch hier sind, denen ich an dieser Stelle schon mal einen herzlichen Dank aussprechen möchte. gesammelt wurde im Prinzip seit der Gründung des Museums. 1862 wurde mit Moritz Wagner ein erster Konservator für die ethnografischen Sammlungen des Bayerischen Staates ernannt. 1864 wurde er dann zum Gründungsdirektor der königlich-ethnografischen Sammlung im Galeriegebäude im Hofgarten. Lucian Schermann konnte das Museum dann in den 1920er Jahren an seinen heutigen Standort umziehen, in die Maximilianstraße und hier direkt die Verbindung zum Nationalmuseum, denn dort befand sich ursprünglich einmal das alte Nationalmuseum. Seit 1957 gibt es dann auch eine feste Stelle für einen Bibliothekar, einen ersten Ankaufsetat, den gab es bereits 1910. 1000 Mark wurden damals zur Verfügung gestellt, um die Bücher zu erweitern, die Sammlung zu erweitern und ein erstes Bestandsverzeichnis wurde erstellt. Inzwischen sind alle 100.000 Bände digital recherchierbar. Seit 2012 sind wir Mitglied im Bayerischen Bibliotheksverband und gerade die Katalogisierung der Altbestände ist in den letzten Jahren abgeschlossen worden. Alles, was vor 2012 ins Haus kam, ist jetzt auch recherchierbar. Und wir freuen uns sehr, dass wir bei Maya jetzt dabei sein können. Und deshalb möchte ich an dieser Stelle einfach auch enden mit einem ganz großen Dankeschön an Herrn Pfisterer und sein Team, die das Projekt initiiert haben und weitgehend umgesetzt organisiert haben und auch den heutigen Abend organisiert haben. Vielen, vielen herzlichen Dank. Und ich freue mich jetzt gleich auf den Vortrag. Dankeschön.
Danke sehr an Sie alle. Wir freuen uns, glaube ich, alle auf den Vortrag von Caroline van Eck, Cultures of Camouflage Among Human and Non-Human Animals. Caroline van Eck ist Kunsthistorikerin, Professorin an der Cambridge University und sie steht eben nicht nur mit ihren Forschungsthemen, sondern auch mit ihren bisherigen Kooperationen im Prinzip für das, was Maya sein könnte, sein sollte. Caroline hat sowohl mit Ruth Bielfeld und der klassischen Archäologie und LMU kooperiert, war aber eben zum Beispiel auch 2018 Panofsky-Professorin am Zentralinstitut. Ich will nur drei Publikationen ganz kurz in Erinnerung rufen, die eben exemplarisch zeigen, was auch Maya leisten könnte. Da ist einmal ihr Buch von 2015, das sich einer grundlegenden ästhetischen Kategorie und Methodenfrage widmet, Art Agency and Living Presence, From the Animated Image to the Excessive Object. Und das sind ihre Arbeiten, die einen großen chronologischen Rahmen in den Blick nehmen, also etwa Translations of the Sublime, the Early Modern Reception and Dissemination of Longinus Perihypsus in Rhetoric, the Visual Arts Architecture and the Theatre 2002, beziehungsweise Piranesi und sein Museum, die Restaurierung der Antike und die Entstehung des Stil Empire in einer sich globalisierenden Welt von 2019. Wir freuen uns sehr auf deinen Vortrag, liebe Caroline. Danke sehr, dass du für Maya nach München kommst.
So, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues and friends, I'm deeply honored to have been asked to give this lecture to celebrate the opening of Maya. And I want to congratulate you all on this wonderful initiative. From Cambridge, we can only look at this with the deepest jealousy and admiration. because in Cambridge, we're in a similar situation that you had in Munich before Maya, in which we have many excellent libraries, but very little actual connections between them and physical connections. So for instance, if in Cambridge you want to borrow a book from a library where you are not a fellow yourself, it's almost impossible. You really need to pull many strings. So I think this will be a very important example for many academic communities across the world to integrate libraries and through libraries create new research questions. So in my talk today, I must confess I have been seduced by playing around a bit with the Maya catalog and going to various museums, and mainly the Museum der Fünf Kontinente, to make the scope of my talk a bit broader, because I thought, well, if you want to talk about these very large global interdisciplinary issues, why not indulge and try to do this today? So in my talk, I will first talk about a problem that has fascinated me for a very long time, which is the problem of animal shapes, zoomorphism. And as Ruth and Ulrich know, I've talked about that many times. I've been working at this lately again. And so I will first talk about grotesque, and in particular grotesque in Florence in the 16th century, then I will broaden the scope of the problem of grotesque. And by this detour, I hope to illuminate the main topic of my talk, which is about camouflage and trying to understand the relations between human and animal camouflage. And I hope you can hear me because I'm not a very loud speaker. Good. Now, when I had the pleasure of being a Panofsky professor here in Munich in 2018, I thought a lot about zoomorphism, so about animal features in objects. And I think animal features and zoomorphism are a very good topic to talk about on this occasion, because they are among the most widespread features and characteristics of human artifacts across the world, from the earliest surviving artifacts from 50,000 BC to the present, and from Alaska to South America, and from China to Florence. And as Ulrich mentioned, my latest work is about Pianesi's candelabra. And in studying the candelabra, I came across these quite unknown designs by Michelangelo. So on the left, you see the candelabra in the Sacristia Nuova in Florence, made the one on the left by Silvio Corsini, one of Michelangelo's assistants around 1530. And on the right by Girolamo Ticciati, introduced or placed on the altar in 1741, but both after a design by Michelangelo, which you see on the right and which is now in the Cooper Hewitt Museum and was rediscovered a few decades ago. Now, when you look at these, what I find very striking, but that may be my deformation, is the presence of zoomorphic elements. So for instance, we see a grotesque animal head here with bat's ears. There are these bird shapes over here. And these return in the candelabra, but also in various objects. Ah, here's a close-up, which shows it much better. So as you can see in the middle, there is a grotesque head on top of the altar. And you can just see the animal snouts on the top. Now, if we walk around in the Sacristia Nuova, we find quite a few animal grotesques. So there is, for instance, on the armrest of one of the prince's statues, there is this hybrid of a bat and what might be a walrus, if Michelangelo knew walruses. There is the strange helmet, which has a snout and this strange top element. There is on the harness of the other prince, there is this grotesque head, which is quite similar to the one we find on this design, also by Michelangelo, for a salt cellar, a saliera. And there are the strange row of masks with eyes behind the first layer of the mask, which are behind this statue group. Here you see the whole layer of masks. If we move outside of the Sacristia Nuova into Florence itself, there's also quite a large number of Cinquecento architectural grotesques. So here we have the Palazzo Non Finito, which by a happy coincidence houses the Florence Anthropological Museum. And I'll come back to that later. Designed by Buontalenti, never finished, as the name says, around 1600. But which has quite a number of grotesques. So decorating or guarding the rooms, the windows, excuse me, there are these animal snouts with wings behind them. Here's a better image, which combine bat's ears with a dog-like snout and the eyes of an unidentifiable animal, and with bat-inspired wings behind them. There's a variety, this one. And here's another one which shows you that behind the animal grotesque mask, there's another set of eyes. So there's a being looking out of the animal grotesque mask at the viewer. This is in the Casino Mediceo, also by Buontalenti, where what at first sight looks like the drapery of a slightly Ionic looking capital, in fact, turns out to be a humanoid face. And here also in the Casino Mediceo, there are the grotesque heads on the ground floor of the Via Cavour of animal heads, which are slightly the worse for wear by now. And one of the most intriguing cases is in the Palazzo Pitti in the Treasury, where I went a few weeks ago and I suddenly noticed these grotesque figurations. I asked the guard who had been there for 20 years, and she told me I was the first person to ask about them in 20 years. And I also asked the director of the Palazzo Pitti, and she also had no clue. So one of the strange features of these grotesques is that once you notice them, they're everywhere in Florence. But if you don't notice them, they just remain under in a kind of subliminal domain. So as you can see, they may have been by Buontalenti, but we know nothing about them, basically. They are dragon's wings with claws over here. And here's another variety where you also have the dragon wings. This is in a room next to the treasury, which should have been a room with a fountain indoors, but which was never finished as such. And where in the middle, you see one of these hybrid bat's heads we also saw in the Sacristia Nuova. So you see this whole proliferation of grotesque animal-shaped hybrid forms that look at us, basically. So, yeah, a few things emerge from this very brief tour of Florence. First of all, these grotesques are very often masks, which on closer inspection reveal to have a face hidden behind the mask. They are very different from what is usually taken as the model for Renaissance grotesque, namely the grotesque rediscovered by Raphael and others in the Domus Aurea in the early 16th century. They are three-dimensional. They don't celebrate the infinite variety and metamorphosis of nature as the Roman frescoes do, but instead they puzzle, they terrify. I'm going too fast here. They threaten, and especially in the case of the Palazzo Non Finito, but also the Palazzo Pitti, they are particularly upsetting because you don't notice them straight away, but once you become aware of them, you realize they have been looking at you all the time. So there is also an element of the uncanny here. So the question I try to answer is a simple one, but very difficult to answer, which is how to understand them. And in particular, their fascinating features, their powers of fascination, which contemporaries of Michelangelo already noted, for instance, Vincenzo Danti in his book on design of 1549, mentions the power of Michelangelo to create grotesque in the Sacristia Nuova that overwhelm and fascinate because they overcrowd, as he puts it, the mind. Now, if you look at the literature on grotesque, it turns out to be not very useful, I'm afraid. Theorizations of the grotesque in the 16th century either try to tame them and to tell you that you can't use them, for instance, the treatises of Pagliotti and Borromeo, or they try to find their origins. They are etiological. They try to trace back the origins of Renaissance grotesque to the grotesque in Pompeii, which Vitruvius already described in such negative and influential terms. So the whole literature about grotesque is mainly about their being licentious, their being contrary to nature, their being too free, their being a kind of visual commentary on the true precepts of mimesis and so on, which is all very different from what we see in these three-dimensional architectural grotesque inspired largely by Michelangelo. So instead, we have to take a step to another domain of human artifacts, namely armor. Because when you compare Renaissance armor, and particularly Renaissance parade and tournament armor to grotesque from the same time, a number of visual similarities become very clear. So for instance, here in this helmet by Giovan Paolo Negroli, one of the main armorers of the 16th century in Italy, we find the same kind of derivation of Corinthian elements over here that we also find in many grotesque. We also find on armor, this is another helmet by Negroli, the presence of animal hybrids that just as in the grotesque in buildings frighten and terrify. And we find that strange duplication, which we also saw in the Palazzo Pitti, for instance, that we have two different animal bodies that are morphed into one. There's also this much studied breastplate of an arm set of a harness for Guidobaldo II della Rovere by Filippo Negroli, which is now in the Bargello, and which shows the same kind of decoration or ornament as the dragon wings that we saw in the Palazzo Pitti. And a few weeks ago, I learned for the first time that clams, when they are still alive, and clams are another very important source for grotesque figuration, when they are alive, have sets of eyes on the rims of the interior, so which looks very similar to So there are these very strong, I believe, visual similarities. There's also, as I mentioned, the very persistent duplication of animal shapes. Here's a helmet for the Emperor Charles V, a la Romana Antica, so inspired on Roman helmets, where you have a proliferation of animals, which very much recalls what we saw in the Palazzo Non Finito. Or again, here in this helmet, a burgonet, for Guidobaldo II della Rovere, which is now in St. Petersburg, and which has at least three animals protecting its wearer and frightening off potential enemies. Another very striking case of the duplication of triplication of animals is this late case by Pietro Tacca of the fountains on Piazza Santissima Annunziata of 1629, where we have this strange animal which has these little tails, a walrus snout, and a kind of harness in the middle. And finally, and this is an important case when we start moving to other parts of the world, there is this helmet, which is made of embossed and repoussé iron and steel with gilding and silver elements, which very much looks like tatouage and sgraffito, I would say. So here, for instance, we have the Palazzo for Bianca Capello, also by Buontalenti, where we see the sgraffito, which is a very similar technique to what has done with this helmet. Now, a lot can be said about potential sources, which I won't do right now because it will take too much time. So we skip all this. But instead, I want to stress that what we have got so far is that we have these very strong visual formal similarities between architectural grotesque and armor, which may have to do with the original meaning of the word ornament, because grotesque ornament, ornament goes back to the Latin ornatus, which can also mean the armor and the equipment of a soldier. So instead of a celebration of variety, metamorphosis, and the creativity of nature, I think it might make sense to think of these architectural grotesques more in terms of defense and protection of buildings, just as helmets and harnesses defend and protect their wearer. Now, a second important aspect of architectural grotesques, especially when we consider them as part of the armor of a building, is that they are very close to being a second skin of a body or an artifact. And here as well, these grotesques of buildings, and think again of the Palazzo Pitti, are very close to armor of the same period. This helmet, for instance, for Charles V, has this very strange duplication of the hair and the beard of the emperor. And I'll come back to this whole issue of duplication later. So there's this duplication or dédoublement of a second skin. There's the duplication or multiplication of animal and hybrid shapes. And these are not that easily accounted for, as far as I know, in 16th century theory of the arts of grotesque or even of monsters, teratology. That is, we find scientific accounts of how such hybrids from monsters could have come into being, but they do not address the question how these hybrids and multiplications function in their actual setting, or even why they proliferate so much at this particular time and place in Florence in the 16th century. So instead, I would argue they should be thought of not as monsters, but in terms of disguise, hiding, camouflage, to which I will come back, and the appropriation of animal characteristics. Now, before we proceed, I want to point out that grotesque are not a European or even an Occidental phenomenon. They are everywhere, in China, Japan, the Pacific, South America. The archaeological museum, one, it's a so-called chamfron, or the head cover of a horse, where we have this strange duplication again that the shape looks slightly horsey, but has Corinthian acanthus motifs, but also a humanoid face and even something that looks like the horn of a unicorn. Sorry. So, for instance, in Florence, in the Anthropological Museum, there is this very interesting shield from the Asmat Islands, which has a very similar kind of grotesque figuration, and also this play on scafito, tatouage, and the second skin. And also in Florence, in the Villa Itati, where I happen to be, there is this Chinese offer of sacrificial vessel from the 8th century AD, which has grotesque animals for handles. And this is one example of thousands. Now, in my view, what this all calls for is an anthropological approach. So, always pursuing the trail of the visual and figurative similarities, let's have a look at some artifacts made outside of Europe. Now, if we think about the duplication or the triplication of features, there's this Tatuana mask from the Museum der Fünf Kontinente, where I took this photograph this morning, hence the poor quality, where we have a similar feature of two faces merged into one threatening figure. There's also the whole very large corpus of masks produced in northwest Canada, in Alaska and Greenland, in what were called Eskimo cultures, where you very often see a human face surrounded by another animal face or part of the face. There are the transformative masks also from Munich. Here we see a raven on top with a gift, but incorporating a human face and surrounded by various attributes that signify the raven and the human being. And I'll come back to this in a moment. Or this other Tiglit mask and another transformative one. Now, this, to my mind, but I hope you will disagree, very much recalls or suggests a similarity with a helmet type called the salad, which is in the shape of a lion's head. You would put it on your head and it would completely integrate and frame your human face. So this is the front. So the human face of the wearer would be inside and you would have the same effect of a human face being framed by these animal shapes. Or again, in this Yupik human fox mask from 46, which is now in Alaska, which plays on this shape shifting between a fox and a human being. Now, as I said, all these similarities, these visual similarities, which are very much strengthened when, as you can do now in Munich, you can play around with the collections of all these wonderful institutions and look for similarities and connections that otherwise you wouldn't be able to find if you would limit yourself to your own disciplinary library. This suggests, I think, that we take a small excursion into the work of the French anthropologist Philippe Descola, whose recent book La Forme du Visible came out in 2021. Descola is the successor to Claude Lévi-Strauss at the Collège de France. And he is quite unique in combining an unequaled amount of actual field work he did himself in Amazonia, Alaska, Greenland, and New Guinea, which he combines with a theoretical model, a structure he has developed to understand patterns of human image making across the world, which is based on a typically structuralist, because he is the true son of Lévi-Strauss, a structuralist classification of relations between human and non-human animals, what he calls ontologies. Now, you can discuss the correctness of that term, but what he has done is with four very simple elements, namely similarity and difference and interior and exterior, he has constructed a classification of all the ways in which human cultures define their relation to nature, to the non-human. And what interests me today very much is his analysis of animism, in which there is a difference of the exterior shape of a being, but a similarity of the interior. So according to the animist ontology, which is the most widespread ontology across the world, you can have beings, and this is shown in this mask, which are on the inside a human, have a human interiority, a human person, but take on the shape or are camouflaged as a fox. But you can also have beings that are foxes on the inside, but that are camouflaged as human beings. So we enter here into the realm of very interesting shape-shifting and metamorphosis. As I said, animism is an extremely widespread ontology. We find it in Amazonia, Malaysia, Siberia, New Guinea, some parts of Polynesia, but also in the Arctic region, as well as the Tierra del Fuego, so it's everywhere. And it's defined, as Descola puts it, by the worldview that there's a similarity of interiority of the soul of the person between animals and humans, so they have the similar interiority, but they have a difference in how they appear externally. So humans can be seals or can take on the disguise or the camouflage of human beings, but animals can also take on the camouflage of a human being. As Descola puts it, animism can be seen as a way to give a systematic form to the experience of the unexpected. A sudden noise, an animal that is turns out to be looking at me, a sudden gush of the wind, all these events break with the ordinary course of life, and they incite, they inspire our imagination to exercise what Descola calls a droit de suite, so the right to make an inference and to infer a presence where one should have been alone and on its own, on one's own. So what happens in these situations is that suddenly, under certain circumstances, for instance, when we realize that an animal is watching us, we lend to non-human beings the behavior and the interior states and the designs, the intentions that are similar to the ones of ourselves. So animism, you could say, is a way of accounting for that experience that we all have, that we can suddenly be looked at by an animal as in the Palazzo Non Finito or the Palazzo Pitti, or that suddenly it turns out we're not alone and that some other being behaves in a way that we can only understand if we attribute to it human traits. Now, in all the parts of the world where an animist ontology is found, the world is populated by a multitude of living beings, which are dressed or camouflaged in an animal or vegetal appearance. But the inhabitants of these cultures who have animist ontologies know they hide an intentionality that is similar to that of humans. So you can have, for instance, leopards or jaguars or frogs that look like frogs, etc., but which in fact are persons that are very similar to us, but simply look in a different way, have a different shape. And this is, of course, where the mask comes in. And it's a very important feature of duplication, because this is the simplest way to figure the inner being of an animal spirit, but also one of the clearest ways to figure, to shape for a human being, that it can take on the appearance of an animal. So it's a very effective way of showing metamorphosis and of enabling the oscillation between one being and another, between the human and the animal, and between two perspectives, that of the human and that of the animal. So I found one which I lost, unfortunately. Let's see. Well, let's take this one. So these are bearskin shoes from Canada, which you might say are simply very effective ways of keeping your feet warm in the terrible cold over there, but which in fact have a much more far-reaching meaning, because they are ways of showing, on the one hand, the bear-like nature of the human being, but also, according to these cultures, if you put them on, they show you how they think an animal looks at them. So they are all about the perspectival play of figuring how they think they actually are, both bears and animals, but also how they think they are perceived by other animals. So you can see how complicated this becomes. And in the Museum of Five Continents, there's a very interesting and very rare dancing mask from Amazonia, which is in the shape of an ocelot, or it's ocelot fur with the spots of an ocelot, with little pieces of mirror to figure the eyes, which is a typical case of a culture producing these artifacts to show how they think the animals in the Amazonian forest see these humans. So you see, we have to take completely leave of normal Western ontologies, in which there's a very clear separation between the animal and the human, and which we have one identity which is consistently presented by our body and the way we dress. Instead, this is a constant play of shape-shifting, which I think is very similar to what happens in these Florentine grotesque and the armor of the 16th century. So if we return for a moment to the Florentine grotesque masks, what Descolar here describes, and it's extremely well documented in his book, is, I think, very similar to the experience suggested by architectural masks, which are animals hidden half by the windowsill that are still observing the spectator before they themselves see the animals, faces that combine different parts of different animals, but also very similar to the helmets we have seen, that also are very similar to transformational masks in the sense that they make you look like a very different animal. So in the very famous Kwakiutl masks, which were worn in British Columbia, there are very often three different animals. So there's the hidden behind these wings with eyes, which is one animal. There's the second animal, behind it is the human being, on top there's yet the third animal. So they really figure this triple external presentation of identity. Now, I mean, if you're feeling increasingly skeptical, I agree with you. And we have to make a very important methodological condition here. The formal similarities between Eskimo masks and grotesque masks made in Florence, these formal similarities, I hope, may be striking and may, I hope, make you think. But the fact that formal similarities occur in very different cultures does not mean that they both belong to the same animist ontologies. What they share instead is a similar solution to a similar problem, which is how to represent the hidden interior of an object or a body in a visual form. So the fact that these objects look similar in some ways doesn't mean that they are the product of the same ontology, because Florentines in the 16th century weren't animists as far as we know. But they show that they share a similar problem and go for similar visual solutions. But that said, it still leaves us with the problem how to deal with these formal similarities among artifacts found in cultures that are very far removed from each other in space and time, and without any evidence of actual historical connections or influence. Now, as Lévi-Strauss put it, if history asked without pause, and which we must ask first, says no, then we have to turn towards psychology or towards the structural analysis of forms. And we have to ask ourselves if internal connections of a psychological or logical nature might help us to understand these similarities. So if history keeps saying no, if there's no evidence of formal or actual influence, what remains is to search for definitions and explanations in psychology, as Lévi-Strauss believed. Or, as I will argue in the second part of my talk, in evolution theory, and in particular, because I believe a major evolutionary mechanism is at work here, which is that of camouflage, and it's human varieties of hiding, disguise, and masking. So I come to the second part of my talk, which I hope will be shorter. So long before the codification of camouflage in evolution theory in the 1860s, we can already see that camouflage, masquerade, and disguise are very common in human culture. Among the oldest surviving human artifacts, there are instances of human masquerading and disguise as animals. There's this cave painting from South Africa from around 30,000 BC. There is this famous mask of a deer skull made from the skull and antlers of a deer, which is now dated to around 877 before Christ and found in 1953 in Berlin, where you see that holes have been made from the wearing, lots of holes here to attach strings to enable its being worn. And this is part of a group of early Mesolithic antler masks or caps, which are found in Germany as well as in the UK in near Scarborough. The oldest surviving description of masquerade in the sense of taking on the shape of an animal to avoid detection is probably Homer's account of Odysseus' escape from Polyphemus by disguising his comrades with sheepskins. As we see here in this painting by Jacob Jordaens, Odysseus in the cave of Polyphemus from the 1630s, which is now in Moscow, where you see how the comrades of Odysseus hide beneath the sheep of Polyphemus' flock. The use of camouflage among animals and humans is well documented from antiquity onwards. Aristotle, for instance, describes the changes of color to adapt to changes in the environment of the octopus. Aristotle, like Plato, made connections between, they make connection between what we would call mimicry, mimesis, and mime or acting. In the literature on fishing and hunting by the Oppians, camouflage is discussed as part of the traps and nets and other devices and cunning that hunters use to catch their prey. And of course, as De Tien and Vernal have pointed out in their study on cunning or metis in Greek culture, the use of camouflage is considered to be shared by animals and humans alike, who can both take on the appearance of both, or the role of both the hunter and the hunted. And marine animals like the octopus in particular excel in the use of adaptive coloration. And as one of these early biological authors write, by means of their techne, octopus disappear into the rock to which they attach themselves. Silent and invisible, hunters and fishermen alike must make themselves into prey. Now, if we move very speedily to the 16th century, We find that in illustrations to of the hunt, we find the so-called phenomenon of the Attrappkuh. This, I think, is a word that exists only in German. So these are models of cows behind which the hunters hide to chase and shoot unsuspecting deer. This is the one by Jacobus Stradanus, engraved by Philip Schalle, and based on Stradanus' designs for the Villa Medici at Poggio a Caiano. And captions to these prints, and there are quite a lot of them, always point to two major elements in subsequent discussions of camouflage. The fictional character of camouflage, so it's make-believe, it's a play, or a very serious one, and camouflage being a kind of dress or costume. And one caption states that hunters kill the frightened deer protected by fictional cows, and the other that the huntsman proceeds in the dress, the exterior of a cow. Now, dissimulation as a wider cultural concept to understand animal and human behavior returns in emblem books. It was often identified as a defining feature of civilized life in the early modern period. You find it in manuals for courtiers like Castiglione's, or in a treatise on honest dissimulation, La Dissimulazione Onesta, by Torquato Aceto, who was often connected to visual depictions of princely behavior, such as Rubens' Medici cycle. And Aceto defines dissimulation as the concealment or disguise of something, as opposed to simulation, which is the pretense of what is not, in affectation, fabrication, or counterfeiting. And thus defined dissimulation unites aspects of what evolutionary biologists today call crypsis, avoiding detection, and masquerade, preventing recognition as a particular species. And indeed, sometimes a connection is made between human dissimulation and animal camouflage. Graziano, for instance, advises the courtier, I quote, that the most practical sort of knowledge lies in dissimulation. Oppose lynxes of discourse with inky cuttlefish of interiority. Let no one discover your inclinations, no one foresee them, either to contradict or to flatter them, end of quote. And this also suggests that dissimulation in humans is often connected to their indulging in their animal and irrational nature. But in this 16th century tradition, something changes in France by the 1660s, so about a century later. Human behavior, and in particular human courtly behavior, is still often analyzed in terms of dissimulation, but the animal increasingly dominates the analysis and the underlying what you might call the dispositif imaginaire, and the means of verbal and visual figuration of such behavior. So as Peter Salins has shown recently in his study 1668, The Year of the Animal, the role and the way animals are perceived in French society changes in the 1660s. They had always been very present, but the relation is defined in different ways. It moves away from the Cartesian radical gap between brute beasts without a soul and the soul-possessing intelligent humans, towards a much greater awareness of the porous, permeable nature of the separation between animals and humans. And this new attitude manifests itself in many aspects of the court and science, for instance, in Louis XIV's installation of a zoo of domestic animals in Versailles, instead of the old zoo at Vincennes, which only had animals that fought. But also, for instance, in the debate about chameleons and the question whether they are sentient beings with feeling or just machines very adept at adaptation to the color of the environment. But also in the book by Marin Curot de la Chambre, the king's physician, who argued that animal behavior shows evidence of intelligence, memory, judgment, emotions, and teachability, as we would say in Cambridge. And this whole rethinking of animal traits of human beings and of this very porous relationship between the animal and the human figures very prominently in what is one of the most detailed studies of human social camouflage ever produced, namely the memoirs of the Duc de Saint-Simon, which he wrote in the early 18th century and were only published in the 19th century because the king had them sequestered. Now, they are extremely vivid and lively accounts of the dire ongoings at the court. But what Saint-Simon constantly does is to describe his courtiers and their characters in terms of animals. So one courtier has the face of an angry cat. There's a couple who are rats on two legs, who fly the court of the dying king just as rats flee the houses on the brink of collapse. Another lady is a woodcock. There's a prince who performs like a circus animal, a marquis who is a furious dog, an abbot who is a vile and dangerous slug, a count who is a poisonous spider, one of the bastard sons of the king is a rattlesnake, another duke is the original snake who corrupted paradise, and the son of the king believes himself to be a dog, whereas the servants of another duke behave like a pack of wild hunting dogs. So there are few actual 100% humans around in this court. And this goes on endlessly. And for instance, one duchess, as Saint-Simon says, looks like a crane of Nubia, which both in her appearance and walk, which is interesting because it was a very favorite being at the zoo in Versailles, but also figures from here. And in contemporary natural history, they were always praised because of their capacity to bow like human beings and for their capacity to play and to act. So these animals also have quite human traits attributed to them. And in one very short passage, when Saint-Simon plays a character and his assassination on the Duc de Noailles, he says that the serpent who tempted Eve, who overturned Adam through her, and who ruined the human species, is the original of which the Duc de Noailles is the most exact, the most faithful, the most perfect copy. A life spent in darkness, closeted, enemy of light, completely occupied by his ambitions, depth without substance, a language of the courtier, jargon of women, fond of dining, without any taste if necessary, but dressed instantly in the tastes of anybody. So here we have the perfect picture of very successful social mimicry in a way that Darwin and Wallace would describe it a century or two later. And this animalization, you could say, of human beings is not restricted to Saint-Simon. We also find it in the famous studies of human slash animal physiognomy that he produced. Where there's a whole series which starts by comparing clear animals and humans to each other, but which evolve as the series progresses into quite hybrid species. Because you neither see swine like that, nor, I hope, do you see human beings who look like this. Because there is, as Sarah Cohen has showed recently, a very consistent hybridization, we would now say, of human beings into this in between genre. And moving to the end of the 18th century, when these plates were exhibited for the first time in public in the Louvre and attracted much more attention than the Mona Lisa at the time, we know from an account by the journalist Sébastien Mercier that he notes that everybody goes to see these plates and not the Italian paintings, why would you? But then they all look very carefully at them, all the visitors, but then they start to compare the faces of people they know with the faces of those hybrid animals. And by the end of their visit, they all slink away, slightly subdued, to cast a furtive glance at the mirrors hanging near the exit to check whether they look like humans or like cattle, eagles, chicken, camels, lions, apes, or swine. And Mercier concludes it's an instinct. So here we have this porosity of the animal and human and this awareness that, as in Descola's ontology of animism, that humans may in fact be poorly disguised animals or animals poorly disguised humans in a very clear case, I think. Now, I think I'm running out of time, aren't I? So a lot could be said about how when Darwin and Bates and Wallace start to theorize mimicry and camouflage in the 1860s, because it offered them the first primary testing ground for their idea of adaptive survival species. When they do so, they constantly talk about or they use theatrical metaphors. So Wallace, for instance, when he talks about mimicry and mimesis in butterflies, camouflage in butterflies, observes, I quote, "They appear like actors or masqueraders dressed up and painted for amusement, or like swindlers endeavoring to pass themselves off for well-known or respectable members of society." And much can be said about this quote. I mean, you could give a whole talk about it. But what he makes clear here is that there's no radical division between animal and human capacities for creating camouflage and being fooled by it. Because, as he then adds, "It's evident that if colors which please us also attract animals, and if the various disguises which have been enumerated are equally deceptive to them as to ourselves, then both their powers of vision and their faculties of perception and emotion must be essentially of the same nature as our own." Same nature as our own. "A fact of high philosophical importance in the study of our own nature and our own relation to the lower animals." So, for instance, this is a very famous case of mimicry among butterflies. So on the left, we have the Thalys, and on the right, we have the Eudomia. And Wallace quotes this as one very clear case of a butterfly taking on the appearance of different species. This one, compared to the further, and that one is found by the subsidy. We now know that this is not the case, and that camouflage and mimicry, in fact, work on different features, but I won't go into that today. But this is the kind of, how shall I put it? The moment that biologists like Wallace and Bates and Darwin start talking about mimicry and adaptive behavior about animals, it's almost impossible for them not to talk about it in human terms, which raises all sorts of issues about intentionality and so on I won't go into. Instead, I come to my conclusion. So I'm aware we've come a very long way from the grotesque and the armor of the 16th century, but I do hope that by all my detours inspired by Maya, I hope to have shown two things, or suggested two things. One is that thinking about widespread features of human material art, such as zoomorphism or masquerade, gets an immense impetus from the connecting of harder to separate collections and intellectual traditions and methods. And second, that there evidently is human camouflage and mimicry, but to understand the relation between camouflage in animals and in humans is a different matter. And the solution I'd like to propose here to end the talk and to open the discussion is to consider camouflage and mimicry as varieties of cultural techniques. And I define cultural techniques here, following the anthropologist Thomas Macho, as a symbolical technique which cannot be produced without a medium, but at the same time cannot be reduced to it. So it allows for self-referentiality or thematization, and the activity itself is older than its conceptualization. So writing and weaving, for instance, or dancing, existed before they were codified in writing or in diagrams of choreographies or instruction how to weave a tapestry. And they are capable of thematization or self-referentiality. We can weave a tapestry about weaving. We can do a dance about dancing, but we can't fish about fishing. Another important aspect signaled by Macho is that cultural techniques are very often techniques of the self. They serve to present or construct a certain identity, which we see very clearly at the court of Saint-Simon. And to his definition, I would add another element, which is that cultural techniques very often emerge on the cusp of the transition from instinctual, innate, and illiterate behavior to cultural and learned activities and artifacts. So writing is a typical case. Writing as a codified activity with an alphabet emerges on the cusp of prehistorical societies, nomadic societies that settle and develop script and notation, like in Mesopotamia. Thinking about human camouflage in these terms would help, I believe, to address the problems raised by evolutionary explanations, in particular that evolution theory has made the relation between animal and human behavior so complex because of the clash between the long durée, the long stretch of evolutionary development in nature, and the short time span of cultural development, something already noted by Gottfried Semper, but also because of the lack of fit between the low resolution of evolutionary analysis, considering developments of species over long periods, for instance, in the case of these butterflies, as compared to the close scrutiny of individual cases in short periods in culture studies, as in these Florentine grotesques, which only lived, so to speak, for about 60 years. Now, what all the instances or approximations of animal and human behavior and appearance mentioned here have in common, particularly in Saint-Simon's animal figurations of camouflage and mimicry, is that they are cultural techniques or practices in the sense outlined here. They arise in the context of an emerging new social and scientific culture. They are all concerned with the construction and presentation of social identities and social selves, and they lend themselves to reflection and thematization. The anecdote by Mercier, I think, is very telling in that respect, as it presents both the first order questioning of the relation between the animal and the human in Lebrun's drawings, but also the second order thematization of that questioning in the reactions of the visitors to the exhibition. Do I look like an animal? Do I look like Lebrun's drawing of a hybrid? Or am I just a human being or an animal in disguise? And what kind of disguise? And similarly, if we return for a last time to Cinquecento, grotesque and armor, we find in the case I showed here a similar thematization of their nature and function to protect, to defend, and to frighten off the enemy in their design. I mean, have a last look at the helmet for Charles V. Why would it be designed as a metal head of hair, if not in this duplication, to reflect on and to thematize its protective function of one of the most vulnerable parts of the human body? And with that question, I will hand over to the audience. Thank you very much.